Good evening and welcome to the NDTV Dialogues, a conversation of ideas. This week, this month, sadly, we've been debating lynching and mob violence. But tonight on the show, we want to look more seriously at why this is happening in the 21st century, at a time when India is the world's fifth largest economy, is progressing in so many ways. Why are we going backwards in the terms of violence and lynchings? Joining me for this is a very special panel, a group of senior lawmakers. I'm joined by Harish Chandra Meena, MP from Dausa, Rajasthan of the BJP, also ex-director general of police. Also with me, Ashwini Kumar of the Congress, former law minister. Also, Mohammed, Salim, Lok Sabha MP of the CPIM. Tathagatha Satpathy, Lok Sabha MP of the Biju Janata Dal. And a new MP, Sonal Mansingh, nominated the Rajya Sabha, a voice of the arts and a voice of reason, as all our panelists are. Thank you very much. Meenaji, if I can begin by asking you, as MP from Rajasthan, where suddenly we're seeing all these incidents being reported. In your view, and with your background as a senior police officer, why do you think this is happening? We had Arjun Meghwalji say that this is a conspiracy against the Prime Minister. Do you actually believe that?
See, my view is whatever is happening is unfortunate. But this is not new as far as the politics of Rajasthan is concerned. I'll just take you back about 10 years back. We had a very notorious agitation in Rajasthan, during which there's mass violence. All trains, all roads were closed. And hundreds of lives were lost. Even policemen on duty, they were lynched. And somehow, such people, they were not brought to book. They were, to date, no one has been arrested. So people, when they know, when they commit an offense in a mob, in anonymity, they have a feeling somehow they'll go scot-free. So if timely action is taken, it helps us in resolving a lot of things. And I would not call it a failure of a particular party or a failure of an individual. It's a failure of the state. State is an institution. Parties, individuals come and go. The state of India states survives. And to protect the life, liberty and property of any individual is the duty of the state. State is the custodian of my fundamental rights. And all these are fundamental rights. So somehow or somewhere if something is going wrong, I feel the various institutions of the state, be it the legislature, be it the executive, be it the judiciary, and even the press. Somehow, all of us are not playing the role which we should have played.
That's a very interesting point, the role of the state. And I think the opposition will argue, and Ashwini Kumar, if I can bring you in on that. The point he's making, and I think the Home Minister has also made the point that when you talk about mob lynchings, 1984 were the first and the most serious incidents of mob lynchings. So when you look at failures of the state and bringing those guilty to justice, it's actually been continuing for years. This is not something which is recent.
Yes, but the point is something that has happened in the past ought to be repeated. And the issue is not whether 1984 was the worst form of lynching or whether today is the worst time for lynchings. The issue is, and as has been rightly pointed out, that somewhere as a state, the Indian state and its instrumentalities have failed to address the problem. But the politics of lynching is something that we have seen for the first time in this country today. And I say so decisively and I say so advisedly and consciously that the politics of lynching used as a tool of politics in terms of polarizing sentiments and in terms of creating a fear psychosis in the minds of those who choose to be contrarian was never witnessed at a scale at which it is being witnessed now. As far as institutions of the state is concerned, I think I would be failing in my duty if I were not to commend the recent decision of the Supreme Court, which in an expansive exercise of its judicial review jurisdiction has directed Parliament to come up with a purposive, comprehensive law against lynching. Now, some may argue that things in India have gone bad not for want of laws, but perhaps for too many laws. That is one part of the argument. But it is equally true that something is necessary to create a fear in the mind of those that you will not go scot-free and there will be a law that will hold you to account. And that is where the role of the state is important. And because the state's role is an issue, obviously the ruling party's responsibilities
Well, let me bring in Tathagatha Satpathy here, who is with the Biju Janata Dal, as we saw in the recent no-confidence motion, neither this side nor that side. But let me just ask you on that, that when politics comes into it somehow, whether it's about saying 1984 is to blame or saying this government is to blame, we actually then don't get into solving the problem because both sides take defensive positions. How are we looking at this as a larger issue of our polity, of our society, of governance, which needs to be tackled. Do you think it's a political issue?
It is partly political, and I would say it is majorly a social evil that we have brought upon ourselves. Our inaction in the past, and I am not blaming any political party as such, all of us are responsible. Over a period of time, you know, whenever anybody is speaking in parliament, they always say, in the past 70, 71 years since independence. Fine, we've had independence since 70 years from the British rule. But what has happened is we have, in the process, killed all social leadership. Mm-hmm. We have overly relied only on political leadership for solving all our problems, whether it is the clogging of our drain, or it is the education system falling through, or it is our financial, economic situation. Whatever it is, we have no experts, we have no economists, we have no social leadership at all. So this over-dependence on the political leadership is unjustified, because the politician today is an average citizen. She or he is not somebody who has dropped from heaven to give solace to everybody. And in the process, with excessive dependence on this one wing of society, which I would consider is a very small wing, because if you see the number of elected representatives in India, it would be something like 6,000, 7,000 people.
No, so you're saying you can't be the solution for everything, but do you think the politicians are to blame for what's happening now?
They would be as much to blame as anybody else. Like Meena Sahib said, it's the state. The state includes everybody. It includes the bureaucracy. It includes the civil society. It includes everybody. The artist, the dancer, like Sonalji, like everybody is part of the state. We are all one country. So if you depend on only one wing of that whole setup, that mm-hmm. large setup, that they alone are the panacea to all evils, obviously it is failing through. Mohammed, and that is what we are seeing today.
Mohammed Salim ji, would you agree? Do you think that what we're seeing now is part of a larger political plan, as Ashwini Kumar says, or as Mr. Meena says, this is actually about a larger problem of the state, of the Indian state?
Of course, it's a bigger problem, but it's a culmination of so many issues. The time will not permit, but it has a psychological aspect, economic aspect, political, social, cultural, religious. It's a culmination. But of course, it's part of political game plan. Now, the political game plan is, you know, in modern world, this lynching was used as an instrument to establish white supremacy in US more than a century ago. The black youths
were... The Ku Klux Klan.
Yes. And then whole world took it as a violation of human rights. And it took decades for the change of societal attitude and legal framework. And in this country, it's not that when Modi ji came to power, it started. But it's slowly, slowly taking up. But the main thing is, if people not like us, then you don't have the right for a dignified life, your livelihood. So then that's how you establish this supremacy. So the Hindutva kind of politics, it's a project, it's a political project. For that reason, it's a majoritarianism kind of politics you have to establish. And earlier it used to be fringe elements. Now you see ministers, elected representatives, even police, even government people, they come not to defend the victims, but to defend the criminals, the perpetrators. And that's how that led to Minister Garland, the criminals. And instead of whole world or the whole country coming together, that you condemn such things. Mohsin Sheikh was first lynched from Prime Minister to Parliament. Everybody was silent. So that's how you give credence to. And putting this 84 versus 2002, that means for one crime against vis-a-vis another crime. So let this continue. Should not be the approach.
I'm going to get Mr. Meena to answer those, but let me just get Sonal Mansingh in as a non-political voice in this. When you look at it, ma'am, as a citizen of India, now, as I said, as a newly elected Rajya Sabha MP, what do you think about what's currently happening with this kind of violence? It can be from a WhatsApp rumor to whether it's about issues of cows and religion. What do you think about it?
When they speak of this mobocracy, the lynchings, the killings, and the mindless violence, what is a mob? Mob is a congregation It's a collective energy gone waste. It's the total mindlessness, like robotic people who have been told, go and do this. I object also to Mr. Salim bringing Hindutva angle. I think no party or no group of people in this country are devoid of such feelings. I'm sorry to say that. Okay. Number two, that the lack of social culture in the daily life and in the education system, increasingly there is a gap, there is a vacuum, and that there is nothing positive or concrete other than films and television and social media to fill that vacuum with positivity, with something that would contribute to the social upliftment. But you see, when you enter a mob, it's not a crowd. A mob is the worst word I can ever think of. Mm-hmm. Mob is just mindlessness. It's like the tsunami. Exactly. So the vacuum has to be filled with good things. And I think the artists have a very big role to play, which has been overlooked for the past decades.
Let me just bring in, well, Mr. Meena, both as an MP from Rajasthan and as an ex-police officer, just some of the issues raised by Mohammed, Salim and Ashwini Kumar. The point about the state actually favouring the accused rather than the victim. In the case of Pehlu Khan, we know that all the people who he named in his dying declaration are out on bail. We know that Pehlu Khan's sons have cases against them for cow smuggling. So again, the victim is actually the one who's facing the crime. Again, what happened in the recent case with Rakhpur Khan, the police are the ones who the Home Minister of the state says are directly responsible for his death because they didn't take him to hospital. When the state seems to be favouring a side, do you think it is about politics?
I would not blame any political party or any individual. See, as per our legal system, the police is independent of the politicians. Police are agents of law, not agents of a
political party. But Mr. Meena, you're really telling me that the police doesn't favor the state government of whichever party, Congress, BJP, or Samajwadi party?
I'll give you an example. Whatever I say is based on facts.
Okay.
During 1984 riots, throughout North India, a lot of Sikhs were massacred, killed. But the state of Rajasthan, which has a very sizable Sikh population, and we are bordering Delhi, mm-hmm. not a single Sikh was killed. Because we had effective police officers. There was a DG called Raghunath Singh. He says no one should be harmed, and no one was harmed.
But we saw in 1984 how the Delhi police abdicated its responsibility.
So that is a failure of an individual.
No, it's failure of the Delhi police. Acting presumably under the same government.
We also had a Congress government there. But nothing happened. So it is, if I fail, I cannot blame my government for it. It's my failure. I have not taken the right thing. Mm-hmm. So we should have people who are competent, who are placed on the basis of their competence, not otherwise. Efficient people, competent people. And you have there's no dearth of such people.
But speaking from Rajasthan, have you seen, you just talked about 1984 when Rajasthan was peaceful.
Yeah.
So why is it that Rajasthan is suddenly seeing so many incidents? You've seen even the traditional musician community, the Manganyars were targeted. You've seen the Mayo Muslim, where again, as you pointed out, Muslims and Hindus have lived in peace in Rajasthan for years. It's not like UP or Bihar or Gujarat, where there has a history of communal riots. Why has Rajasthan changed?
Sonia ji, just give me an example.
Sure.
We talk of various political parties. In Rajasthan, we just have two political parties. We don't have regional parties.
Mm-hmm.
Which political party do you think, when it selects its candidates, they are on merit? Either they see his caste, they see his creed, what is the... So everyone practices this.
Mm-hmm.
So if you lose, you blame someone else. All of us as Indians, we have to rise above these things. Look in the person's qualities, his abilities, his aptitude, and not his caste.
Mm-hmm.
And I should be punished for my acts, not for my caste.
Mm-hmm.
But what is happening? Every political party. In UP, you see this community is supporting this, he'll win. You don't see the candidate. So when individuals, and I'll give you another example. And all states probably, but I spoke in the parliament also on this issue.
Mm-hmm.
It's the lawmakers who make the law. Either the MLAs or the MPs, not the councillors, not the Gram Panchayat. For a Gram Panchayat sarpanch, you have to be educated. You can't have more than two children. He doesn't make law, he follows law. But for a lawmaker like me, I can be uneducated. I can have as many children as I want. And I'm paid for it. So what are you paying? Competence or incompetence?
No, I agree with you. You're still not answering whether the state here is siding with the accused. Is the state siding with the criminals like Mohammed Salim said?
See, as state, police does not, it's not, when police does not work in isolation, there's a system called criminal justice administration system,
mm-hmm.
in which it's the police, the prosecution, the magistracy, judiciary, and the jails. All of them, police should be, and police is, as per law, accountable to law, to the judiciary, not to a political master.
You want to respond, go ahead.
Coming to the concrete, a former police officer, and he candidly accepted what's happening, the things. But then in this case, the police is squarely blamed because it took 4 hours to 6 hours to take the victim injured to the nearest hospital, which is 6 kilometers away.
They had tea in between.
There's no judiciary, no prosecution, by the time no FIR, just you have to rescue and put him to the hospital for the treatment. And that is how this connivance is. And now that the lower level it is there, it's a human failure. When it's come to the upper level, it's a system failure. So whole state is to be blamed. But actually, the problem is that the societal mind change. We will see that if you are not speaking like me in the language, same language, you are not behaving like me, you are not wearing the clothes I wear, you don't eat what I eat, and you don't, your way of worship is different than mine. That means people like us and people not like us. If people is not like us, then you don't have a right to a life of dignity with dignity. That's the problem. That's the societal attitude is being changed. And I'm telling you again and again, when Akla is not new, the art, people of art and culture, they have a great role for this societal attitude to be changed positively. But then after Akla Khan was murdered by the same kind of thing, and Award Vapsi, that's famous thing, Padma Shri, Padma Bhushan, all these various fields, people, this, what the government said that time, this should have acknowledged the problem is emerging and you have to tackle this. But instead of that, it's a manufacturing dissent. And they've tried to sideline the entire thing. Sorry. The signal was there. They have failed to take that cognizance.
You want to respond? Go ahead. When activists speak, he says that they're targeted for being anti-national. Go ahead.
I was targeted, Mr. Salim, for having been appointed chairman of Sangeet Natak Academy by NDA. I was for the first time No, because you're CPM. And UPA won.
Hello, from the issue.
Second, Mr. Salim.
I know.
This is not parliament. Hello.
No, I'm saying
Let me speak. Please. I do not like to be interrupted.
Please.
With 64 CPM MPs, UPA 1 came into power. And that is when the first political interference in the field of culture happened in independent India. There was intolerance, total intolerance. We were swept out with a jhadu. Why? Not because I was incompetent, not because I had shown any...
Let her finish her point.
Wrong is wrong. No, but let her finish what she's saying. Go ahead.
So what I'm saying is that pointing fingers at other parties, taking one each name, then I can also say that I read newspapers, I see, I watch TV. What happened during CPM rule in West Bengal for 34 years or 37 years? What happened now with Trinamool, you know, those hangings of those poor boys? See, selectivity and selective amnesia does not help. I'm sorry. Selective amnesia does not help.